Okay, let us start. Good morning. So yesterday I started to discuss the existence of divergences in the perturbation theory of the 5-4 theory, but we didn't really start to discuss renormalization, what it means, how to renormalize the theory, namely to define an ultraviolet finite quantum theory, and what it means, this procedure of renormalization. So that's what we are going to do today. So we are going to treat the renormalization of the 5-4 quantum field theory in dimension 4. Sorry. At one loop, of course, keeping the first non-trivial order in perturbation theory. So remember what we did. We start from the 5-4 theory. Once again, I write the action. Once again, I am working in the Euclidean framework because I don't have I factors, but that's, you can do the same calculation in Minkowskian framework. And we saw that the two-point function, the irreducible two-point function, let us call it gamma 2 of p, and that will be, I take its Fourier transform, so I'm looking at the irreducible two-point function in Fourier in momentum space. This is given by this diagram, which means it's p squared plus m squared. That's the classical term. And then I get a factor, which is g over 2 times a function t of m, which basically represent this propagator, the truncated propagator, plus g 1/2 this tadpole propagator. Okay? So this is the amplitudes of the, sorry, not the, the tadpole propagator, the tadpole diagram. Okay? And if you work on the irreducible four-point function, let me denote it gamma hat of p1, p2, p3, p4. So now it depends on 4 incoming momenta, P1, P2, P3, and P4. And it is given at a classical leaning order by just the vertex. So there is a coupling G. This is a coupling times this vertex. So this means 1. And then there is a sum of the contribution of 3 diagrams . So they are the same diagram, but the momenta here are momentum P1, P2, 3, 4. This is 1, 3, 2, 4, and this is 1, 4, 2, 3. Okay? So you see that this irreducible four-point function can be written as just the coupling constant G minus G squared over 2. Sum times some function that represents the Feynman amplitude associated to this diagram. So I call it B for like bubble or something like that. And of course, it depends on the sum of the incoming momenta. So it's a function of P1 plus P2 here. Then this will be a function of the second one will be a function of P1 plus P3. And then the third graph corresponds to the same function with P1 plus P4. Okay? And now, what is this function? This function, T of M. Well, it's just a function of the mass. It's just the integral over the momentum K, let us call it capital D, of the propagator, 1 over K squared plus M squared. Okay? This, of course, depends on M, on the mass, too. So this is the Euclidean propagator. And the function B now depends on some external momentum P incoming here. And it depends on the mass. And it will be given by the integral over the internal momenta that is carried by this loop. So this is this diagram, let us say. You have a momenta here. Well, this is given by this diagram. You have two propagators. You have an incoming momentum P that goes out here. And so this is this propagator has a momentum K. This propagator carries a momentum K, plus P. So this is 1 over K squared plus M squared times 1 over P plus K squared plus M squared. Okay. Well, these are the formula for the Euclidean calculation. Remember, if you are working at real time, you replace this by the Feynman propagator, so it's minus I. And you replace the coupling constant by minus G. That's the only. So this is Euclidean setting. Okay? So now you see that this integral is divergent at large lambda, at large k, because it diverges like an integral over k in d-dimensional space over t. And if I am in 4 dimensions, this is d equal 4. So in fact, this is integral diverges when the dimension of space-time is larger or equal to 2. This integral is better behaved, but it still diverges as the dimension of space-time is larger or equal to 4. Okay. And these two divergences come from the fact that, as we have seen, the quantum fields are some very, very singular objects. For instance, this comes simply from the fact that we have seen this is just the diagram which of the vacuum expectation value of the product at the same point of two free fields in the free field theory, and we have seen that this is infinite. Well, the divergence here is a little bit more involved. It comes from the definition of the phi-4 operator, but I will come back to that later. So we see that you have I momenta, or energy, divergences. And high momenta means small distances. This means that the properties of the quantum theory at short distance are very singular, much more singular than what we would expect from a classical theory. And so divergences are called ultraviolet branches. So how do we manage with those divergences? So those divergences appeared first Of course, when people started to quantize quantum electrodynamics, so the interaction between the Maxwell field, that is a free field theory of non-interacting photons, and the Dirac field of electrons, the field describes the second quantized theory of electron and positons. Okay. So, and the solution for that was this procedure of renormalization. So I'm going to explain that, but before that, I'm going to discuss a little bit more this ultraviolet divergence. So, if we want to deal in a consistent way into those ultraviolet divergence, one way to do that is to introduce an ultraviolet regulator or cutoff. It means that we modify the theory, at high momenta, so that it is well behaved. Okay, at high energies. And this seems a mathematical trick, but in fact, nowadays, we understand that there is some physical reason to do that. Because let me draw just a line which represents energy scales. Okay? And, well, atomic physics, you know, when quantum mechanics started, people were studying atoms, interaction of the electromagnetic field with the atoms. Therefore, the energy scale for the electromagnetic field is of the order of 1 eV. Okay. Now, when people started to do nuclear physics, they studied the structure of the proton, of the neutron, of the nuclei. So the basically idea is to study at the mass of the MeV. Okay, so this was nuclear physics. This is atomic physics, atomic and molecular physics. This is nuclear physics. In high energy physics, when people to study QCD, they were basically working at the order of the energy of the GeV. And now we are at the energy of the TeV. We are making experiments at the order of the energy of the TeV. So this is LHC X physics, etc. This is nuclear physics. And that, let's say, hadronic physics. Okay. But we know that much above, there is a Planck mass. Where quantum gravity enters into the game. In between, we don't know really what's happening. People have a lot of idea. Many doesn't work, but that's it. And we know that there is some high energy cutoff where, in some sense, quantum theory as we know it must break down simply because the concept of space and time of a smooth, regular, classical space-time described by the general relativity theory breaks down. So there are a lot of interesting proposals to what should be a quantum space-time, but anyway, this is some kind of, this can be viewed as the maximal energy where ordinary QFT works. Okay. So it doesn't, when we are doing calculation in quantum field theory, we must always remember that it doesn't make sense to make calculations. So we must stop somewhere. So the only question we have to ask is whether if we make calculation assuming there is some high energy cutoff, And if we go down here, do we get sensible results? So the question is, do we get sensible results that which does not depend, do not depend on Planck scale physics? Because we don't know what Planck scale physics is. OK. So introducing a cutoff like that is something which is physically sensible. It's not only a mathematical trick. So now, how can we modify the, introduce such a regulator? First, so here are some examples. First, discretize space-time by replacing a continuous space-time, for instance, time Higgs, by a lattice. For instance, by a lattice, okay? With, of course, a minimal distance and a minimal time, okay? In fact, it's an idea that goes back to Heisenberg. Heisenberg proposed in the 30s that to deal with those infinities, space-time has to be considered as some discrete. But in fact, it becomes very, very useful in the 70s when studying gauge theories. Okay. Of course, if we do that, we lose something very important. We lose Lorentz invariance, or Poincaré, in fact. Well, Poincaré is still discrete, but we lose definitely is lost. We cannot make continuous. Okay. So a second idea is rather it's to discretize momentum space. So it's basically change the propagator. Okay. So act. So introduce a regulator in momentum space. Okay. So that the propagator doesn't behave like 1/k², but it has a better behavior at high momentum. Okay. So there is one very simple-minded idea, which simply is to define that the propagator, instead of being 1/k² plus n², I'm still working in Euclidean setting, but you can do that in a Minkowski setting. I said the propagator is this if the momentum k in its modulus is less than some momentum cutoff. Regulator. And it is zero. Is k is larger than lambda, okay? That's what is called the sharp momentum cutoff. And that's the one I will be using in most of the calculation, because that's the simpler and it gives sensible result makes simple calculation at one loop. Okay. Well, a more involved way to regularize this is to change the propagator by changing the propagator by saying that the propagator is 1/k² plus m², but then I had add something like k to the fourth divided by lambda 2, where lambda is still the momentum regulator. Because you see that if you use such a regulator, basically The propagator behaves like 1 over k squared plus m squared for small k, but when k is larger than lambda, it behaves like 1 over k to the 4. So it goes down much, much faster, and it makes this integral here divergent, or better behaved. So this kind of regulator is called a Poulivillard regulator. And you see that this amounts to change the numerator of the propagator. This amounts to change in the action, the kinetic term in the action, which is d phi squared plus m squared, by adding a term which will be 1 over lambda squared plus phi squared, of course. So this is a mass term. This is the ordinary term involving derivative in space and time. And we had a term which is 1 over lambda squared, the Laplacian phi squared. So here we have two derivative terms, and here we have 4 derivatives terms. So it means that I replace in the action the d phi squared by d phi squared plus 1 over lambda squared d squared of phi squared. Remember, as usual, this is the Laplacian, which is d mu d mu. Okay. And you see that if you introduce such a modification of the theory, it's quite clear that Lorentz invariance is satisfied, because as it is, this is written in a covariant way. Okay? Well, so you could think it makes a perfectly sensible quantum field theory. Well, so that's that's a good point. But in fact, there is a bad point, which is that the theory is not unitary. If you work out, for instance, if you take this propagator and apply the Chalon-Lehmann representation, you see that the propagator has a heavy mass particle, but the matrix element, the square, the modulus of the matrix element involving this massive particle are negative. So there is a particle with mass lambda, with mass of the order of this ultraviolet cutoff that modifies the dynamics, but typically, if we take this particle of mass lambda and we compute a matrix element between the vacuum of this, and we make the calculation, we found something which that is negative, bad. Yeah, so we lose something. And so you see that usually introducing such an ultraviolet regulator, you have to pay some price. You have to break explicitly some of the explicit properties, some of the explicit symmetries of the quantum theory. So of course, the question is, can we recover in the lambda goes to infinity limit a sensible quantum theory? So the idea is introduce an ultraviolet regulator, lambda, and then can we take a sensible limit lambda goes to infinity? Okay? So third kind of regulation is dimensional. Well, this is called a regularization. To introduce a regulator is a procedure of regularization. And dimensional regulation assumes that the dimension of space-time is basically 4 minus epsilon, with epsilon a small number. So space-time dimension is not an integer. So it seems a bit of magic. I think you heard about it both in the quantum statistical mechanics course and the QFT1 course, but it works very well, very nice, in particular for Young-Mills theories. It has a lot of advantages, but of course, again, you lose unitarity and a lot of things because you don't really know. Well, if you ask a mathematician, what is a space-time with a Minkowski signature and with a non-integer dimension, it tells you that you don't really know. So you can make calculation, but still we don't completely understood what's the mathematical structure behind dimensional regularization. Nevertheless, it's a very nice regularization and a lot of results are not on that. Okay. So now let us go back to just this regularization because that's the simplest one. Okay. And let us compute this function, T of M, which is given by this integral. And let me compute it in D equal 4. Well, so let me now introduce this cutoff lambda. So I take this integral and I just modify it by the integral. Then, of course, this integral is very easy to compute because it's just T integral d4k over 2 pi to the power 4. I just integrate over a four-dimensional ball where the momenta are smaller than lambda, and 1 over k squared plus m squared. And that's quite easy because you can separate radial coordinates and momenta. So, and the momenta. So remember, I can write that k is a four momenta, but it can be written as u times k, where u is a form vector of norm 1. You can integrate over u. You get simply the volume of the three-dimensional sphere, unit three-dimensional sphere in four dimensions. So you get something like some number times integral dk. There is a volume key k3, 1 over k squared plus m squared. But you integrate now k from 0 to lambda. Remember, this was a momentum, this was a momentum. Okay. So, if we do the calculation, well, you see very easily that this is expected to diverge like lambda squared, symbolico, because this is, I have a term of degree 4 in the momenta divided by a term of degree 2. So this must diverge that as lambda 4. If you want to compute the leading divergence like lambda 4, you can neglect m squared. So you simply have to compute a very simple integral. Well, you can compute this integral in general. And the result is that the coefficient is 1 over 4 pi squared. Okay, so it's a simple exercise to compute this coefficient. Now, these integrals depend on m also. So there is a correction in m squared. If you do the calculation, you think that there is a correction, which is small when m is small. So it has to be proportional to m squared. You can expand this numerator, this denominator in terms of m squared, and then you get a correction of order m squared. So the correction of order m squared, so this comes from an integral dk over k. Over k to the dk times k. Here you have a coefficient which be integral over dk divided by m squared over k. So you expect a logarithm of lambda. Compute this logarithm of lambda, and with the correct normalization, you find minus 1 over 4 pi squared. Okay, so that's just results of simple calculation. Exercise, do this calculation. Okay, of course, it will be a logarithm of lambda squared over m squared because it has to be dimensional. But then you get finite terms. Okay, so this is a leading divergence. It's just proportional to the momentum cutoff. And this is a correction in terms of the mass, which is logarithmic. Okay. Now let us consider this function. Because here, of course, we had three times the same function. So let me consider the function B of P M lambda. That corresponds to B of P M is just the amplitude associated to this diagram. Okay? With an internal momentum P coming here. So this is D 4K 2 pi to the 4, 1 over K squared plus M squared, 1 over P plus K squared plus M squared. And again, let us introduce this regulator. So basically, we assume that K is less than lambda, and also that P plus K is less than lambda. So we're integrating over the union of two balls in momentum space. Okay. So it's a more complicated divergence, but there is no need to compute exactly what is this complicated integral, because you see that the divergence comes from the fact that what's happening when K is very large. So we assume that P is much, much smaller than lambda. And in this case, what's dominant is just these terms, K squared, and here this K squared term, because M and P are much less than lambda. So these integrals diverge like precisely this integral, d4k over 2 pi to the 4, 1 over k 4, which is a k squared. So it's still an integral that diverges logarithmically, and that is the same, exactly the same integral that the integral that appears here. So the result is simply that this behaves like 1 over 4 pi squared times logarithm of lambda squared plus finite terms. And these finite terms will, of course, contain the P and the M dependence. Okay, but the divergence doesn't depend on P and M, so it's simpler. This is independent of the momenta and of the mass. Okay? Good. So now we are ready to discuss the renormalization of the theory. So let's keep here those important technical results, and let's go back to the physics. We have a theory here, which is we have a field phi. If G equal to zero, that's just the second quantized theory of Klein-Gordon particles of mass m and spin zero. So we have a theory where we have massive particles, massive spin zero particles that obey the Klein-Gordon equation. And we have an interaction into phi to the four, and an interaction into the phi to the four correspond to having a vertex of interaction like that. So if you go back to canonical quantization, you see that this corresponds to a contact repulsive interaction. If two particles meet together, they repel each other with a strength proportional to G. So they behave a little bit like BR balls, but with a smooth interaction. So they don't, they cross each other, and sometimes they interact with a probability proportional to G. But there is some repulsive interaction, but local contact interaction. Okay. So we don't expect such in such a theory of particles that have a repulsive interaction. We don't expect that they are bound states. They do not attract themselves. So we expect that the spectrum of the theory is just a particle, a massive particle, plus n particle states. But they can interact. Okay. And so remember now the Chellen-Lehmann spectral representation. We expect, therefore, that the spectral function, rho, as a function of mu squared, has the following form. There is a particle of mass m, and then, starting at mass, I'm sorry, 4m squared, there is a continuum. But this continuum may be complicated. It's just not a continuum of free particles. Okay. So now the question is, what is this mass? Particle. So the physical of particle of the theory. We have seen from the Chellen-Lehmann representation that if we consider the Feynman propagator in momentum space, p squared, we expect that it has a pole. It has a pole at p squared equal minus this physical mass, m squared. And let me write this physical. Well, m is the physical mass of the particle. Remember, I'm using p squared equal minus e squared plus k squared. So a pole at p squared equal minus m squared means that the energy of the particle is m. So it's positive. Okay. It's not a tachyon. It's a physical particle. Okay, and we know that it has a pole, and that the residue of this pole is just minus I times expectation value of the phi operator at point zero between the vacuum of the theory and this one particle state. Let us call it M. One particle state. State. This is a vacuum state. And squared. Okay. And this is a field operator. So now we know that if we go back to Euclidean time, that where this will become the I will disappear, we know that G of p squared minus 1 is the two-point function. Well, of course, this depends on p. Okay. So the inverse of the two-point function is the irreducible two-point function. And we have computed the two-point function above. This is p squared plus m squared plus g 1/2 t of m plus higher order correction. Okay. So you see that immediately that the physical mass of the particle is given by the equation m squared plus g 1/2 t of m plus I order terms. So it is different from the mass of the theory we started from. And as I explained yesterday, this is a renormalization effect. The mass of the physical state of the particles, that is the results of a particle interacting with itself in the vacuum, is different from the mass of the theory we started from in the calculation. Well, that's something that occurs already in classical physics, because as I told you, as explained, for instance, if you consider electrons in a metal, the electrons have an effective mass that is different than from the mass of the electron in the vacuum. So particle interacting with something even already at the non-relativistic level, masses gets renormalized. Okay. So the novelty here is that this renormalization effect contains infinity. Okay. So now you can also ask yourself, so here I consider the mass of the particle. Okay. Well, you see that the residue here is still one. You still have p squared plus something. So you see that there is a renormalization effect for that. You see that there is no renormalization for the field operator at that order. You see that computed like that. The matrix element that we have computed equal one. Okay, plus terms of order g squared. Okay. But in fact, that's not, this will not be true in general. Which means simply that the phi, the field operator that we are using in our calculation, is not normalized in a proper way, so that when applied to the vacuum, it creates a particle state of mass m with the correct normalization. But the field operator is just an operator of the theory. So usually when one defines the field operator, one says this is an operator that is normalized so that when it's applied to the vacuum, it creates a one particle state with the correct normalization for the vacuum, for the one particle states. So if this is not true, it means simply that we are not dealing with the field operator, with the local operator, with its standard normalization, but with another normalization. Okay. So in general, not true in general, field operators, the field operator phi needs also to be renormalized. Okay. And finally, we may ask, what is the coupling constant of the theory? That is the coupling of the theory. And this coupling turns out it needs to be also renormalized, but I'm going to discuss that a bit later. Also normalized, but see a bit later the discussion. Okay. So the idea of renormalization is that we shouldn't try to express the quantity we are interested in terms of the quantity M and G of the original action, we should express them in terms of the physical or renormalized quantity, because that's the one we measure when we have a theory, a quantum system, which contains spectrum with particles. What we measure is the mass of the particle. So the idea is that idea of renormalization express physical quantities, let us say physical correlation functions in terms of measurable parameters of the theory. Okay. Instead. And in particular, the idea is that to quantize the theory, in fact, what we should do is the following. We should start from a functional integral over some field phi. Okay, let me still work in the Euclidean, but that's the way. With what is called a renormalized action, phi. With this renormalized action, it's of the same form than the action we started from. So it is an integral over space-time of, there is a term d phi squared. There is a term like phi squared. There is a term like phi to the 4. But we don't know really what are the parameters we have to introduce here. So let us just say that there is a parameter A divided by 2. There is a parameter B divided by 2. And there is a parameter C, well, normalized like factorial 4. Okay, and the question is, which A, B, and C should I take to get a sensible physical theory when the cutoff goes to infinity? Because here I introduce lambda. And that's all what we can do. It doesn't make sense to do something else. Okay. So I'm going to apply this idea of renormalization to a simple case, which is a massless phi 4 theory. First, why am I interested into a massless field theory? Well, first, it makes one parameter less. The massless phi 4 theory depends only on the coupling constant, since we have set the mass to 0. So let me write the classical action for a massless phi theory. It's simply 1/2 d phi squared plus g over 4 phi to the 4, okay? The mass is equal to 0. But this theory has a very interesting property in 4 dimension, if I am in 4 dimension. It has a property of scale invariance. Scale invariance means that if I change phi of x into a phi lambda of x defined by lambda phi of lambda x, which means I'm performing a scale transformation. I'm both dilating the space and making a dilation of the field. Yes?
When you make the dilation of the field, shouldn't it be to the scaling dimension of the field?
Yes, but that's the scaling dimension of the field. Let me continue. Let me end. You'll see immediately. Then you see immediately that if I compute S of the action for this phi lambda, this is always equal to S of phi. Okay? That's simply because I can make the change of variables x into lambda x here, in this term here, and you check that all powers disappear. Okay. And you see that this is G being fixed. Okay. So this means that, in fact, let's say the scaling dimension of the field phi is said to be equal to 1, and the scaling dimension of the coupling constant is said to be equal to 0. Because when you make this scale transformation, you don't need to make a change on the value of the coupling constant to get the same action. So in four dimensions, the coupling constant, the constant G, is dimensionless. But only in four dimensions. OK. So this is for the classical theory. Now I'm interested, of course, into the quantum massless theory. So in order to, what does it mean to have the quantum massless theory? To have the quantum massless theory means, of course, that I want to, that the physical mass is equal to 0. Okay? Not the mass in the parameter. I want that the two-point function as a zero or pole for the at p square equals 0. Okay. And then of course, from this equation, this means that the mass m here cannot be 0. This parameter plus this parameter has to be equal to 0. So you can check that in order to have a physical mass, a mass physical equal to 0, what you have to take is, of course, you can still keep a factor a equal to 0 because the residue, the two-point function here will still start like b squared. You see? But what you have to do is to take a equal 1. But we have to take b, the coefficient here, to be equal to zero at classical order. But then there will be a change in the coupling constant, which will be equal to G. And then I have to take the value of T of M when M is equal to 0. So I get minus 1/2, 1/4 pi squared, lambda squared. Here I take 0 times g plus term over the g squared. Okay. And so if I take, I haven't specified here what is c. I consider that c is just a coupling constant plus something I will discuss just in a moment. You see? So you check that if I take this choice for a, this choice for B, and at the moment I don't specify what is the coefficient C, then the two-point function is simply P squared plus a term of order G squared. Okay. So now, of course, we are going to discuss the coupling constant. And that's where things get very interesting. No. Well, here is the expression for the four-point function. And you have seen that the four-point function contains a logarithmic divergence. Okay. But now I have to define what is a physical coupling. And how do I define a physical coupling? Well, in high energy physics, you measure the couplings between particles by doing scattering experiments. Yes?
In the expression there for B, why do you neglect the logarithmic divergence term?
Because the logarithmic divergence is proportional to m squared, and m squared is equal to zero at leading order. You see? So I get zero times the logarithm of lambda. This will come out if we consider a theory that has a renormalized, non-zero physical mass. See. Okay. But that's a good question, because that's a subtle point.
Isn't
yes, in fact, what you should take in this expression is that you compute at that order. Yes, what you should do, in fact, I've been a bit short. What you should do is that you compute the two-point function, and let us take it, well, let's write it here first. Okay, what, in fact, what I'm doing if I do that is that I start from this action. I compute the two-point function, gamma 2. This is, of course, A P squared plus B M squared plus C 1/2. This is a new coupling constant. Integral over D 4K 1/A K squared plus B. You see? So this is, well, let us fix A equal to 1 for simplifying. This will be P squared plus B. I'm sorry, there is no M squared, of course, it's just B. Plus B plus 1/2 C T of B. And then I plug again the expression for T of B. So I replace M squared by B. And I replace G by A, G by C. But now you see that if I replaced M squared by B, I get B is zero plus a correction of order G. So T of B will be 1/4 pi squared lambda squared minus 1/4 pi. At leading order, it will be zero plus some correction of order G times log of lambda squared. So it's indeed 1/4 pi squared lambda squared. So this is 1/4 pi squared lambda squared plus O of C is G plus is G. This is a term of order G plus G squared. But this is 0 minus G 1/2 1 over 4 pi lambda squared. So you see that this cancels this. So this fixes B. Okay? Good. Okay. So now go back to the four-point function. Yes?
You were saying that the coupling constant also gets renormalized, right?
Yes.
So in those expressions for A, B, and C, that G is the renormalized.
Yeah, at the moment, G should be replaced by C, but C is equal to G at first order. So if I made a modification to C, it will be contained here and here, because this doesn't depend on G, and this depends on G. So for at the moment, I'm consistent. See. Okay. So a physical coupling is obtained by, in fact, some scattering experiments. So you measure some scattering factors. And you have seen, in fact, in the QFT course, that scattering experiments are related to the green functions of the theory through a formula called the LSZ reduction formula. So they are related to those are S-matrix elements. And these are related to the four-point functions. Okay. So I'm going to define. So I take as a definition. I'm going to define a renormalized coupling constant that I defined GR as the value of the irreducible four-point function. This is the irreducible point function of my theory at a reference point in momentum space. So I choose some specific choice, P1, P2, P3, P4 of momenta. And I make the measurements. I go back from these measurements. I assume that I'm off shell, for instance, on shell. I go back from this to the value of the four-point function for some specific space of momenta. And I said this is this number. By definition, I call it a renormalized coupling. It's not good. Just renormalized coupling. It depends on the way we decide. So definition, I define a renormalized coupling like that. So now let's go back at the form of the four-point function for the massless theory. And then we run into a little subtleties, and that's in fact an important point. We have seen that the irreducible four-point function contains ultraviolet divergent terms. That's because this function B of P and M contains 1 over 4 pi squared logarithm of lambda squared terms. Okay. Now, for the massless theory, of course, this diagram, and therefore the four-point function, cannot depend on the mass. You see? And it's a dimensionless number. It's just a pure number. So it depends on the ultraviolet cutoff, and that's fortunate, because the only way to get a momentum dependence of this function is to make it a function of the dimensionless ratio of P squared with the cutoff. So if we have computed the cutoff dependence of the integral, we know the momentum dependence of the integral without any more calculation. That's just a dimensional argument. And of course, then you have some constant that you have to compute. That is, and this constant, in fact, depends on the regularization. But it's not, but it is not important, as we shall see. Okay. So you see that the four-point function, the four-point function of the series, P4, well, it's written here. I don't need to rewrite it. So you see, it depends on the momentum. So if I want to define GR of the value of the irreducible four-point function at a reference point in momentum space, so choosing some P's, it will depend on the value of the P's. Yes? No, I get that by doing the explicit calculation. But once I get the explicit calculation, I get this log plus some number. I don't know, it depends, but I think it's one if I compute just with a sharp cutoff like that, but it could be two or zeta of three, or I don't know, it depends. But in fact, once you get this result, you think a little bit and you say, oh, but it couldn't be something else. Because we have a function that is a dimensionless function depending only on P and on the cutoff. So it can only be a function of P divided by the cutoff. And since we know that it's a logarithm of the cutoff plus some dominant term, we know the dominant term. Okay? Good. So this depends on P. So you have to choose a reference point. So what I'm going to do is that I will choose the reference point by fixing what is called a renormalization scale, some number mu. So this is a mass. Mass or energy. You see, it can be one EV, one MEV, one GEV, one TEV. It simply has not to be equal to the Planck mass because the Planck mass is, for instance, the lambda. Okay. So this renormalization scale, of course, has to be over the one. So let's see, much smaller than the cutoff. And then for simplicity, I will take the reference point such that P1 plus P2 reference squared equal P1 plus P3 reference squared equal P1 plus P4 reference squared equal mu squared. It's just for simplicity. It makes the calculation simple, but you could have chosen something more complicated. Well, it's symmetric. There is some symmetric reference point. Okay? And of course, you could say that, you could remark that this mu squared is positive. This reference point lies in the Euclidean region in momentum. So they do not correspond to a physical scattering experiment where the P are on the mass shell, so they are in the Minkowskian regime. But it's not important. You can, if you know that, you can do the calculation in perturbation theory and obtain the results of the scattering experiments. So take it as a definition of the renormalized coupling. Okay. So then, if I am doing that, I found that my G renormalized is simply the original G, and remember here my original G is a C. minus 1/2 c squared 1/4 pi squared. Then I have, of course, logarithm of lambda squared divided by mu squared with a factor of 3. So if I start from an action like that, this is the value of my renormalized coupling. Okay? And now, let me re-express my four-point function for value of the momenta that are not equal to the reference point. They are given by C minus 1/2 C squared 1/4 pi squared. Well, of course, I have this constant. Then I have logarithm of lambda squared over P1 plus P2 squared plus same thing for P1 plus P3 plus same thing for P1 plus P4 plus 3 times this constant. Okay? This is just the result of the perturbative calculation. And let me re-express this of GR. Well, I get, of course, here. So I just invert. I express C in terms of GR up to second order. Here I just GR, and what I get is just 1/2 GR squared 1/4 pi squared times, and then the logarithm of lambda disappear between this one and this one. So what you get finally is, well, let me show because I'm a bit, this is, so me a bit up and goes up. So I get log of mu squared divided by P1 plus P2 squared plus logarithm of mu squared divided by P1 plus P3 squared plus logarithm of mu squared divided by P1 plus P4 squared, and that's it. You see? The log lambda have disappeared, and the constant as well. So, if I invert this formula, it means that the C I had before, oh no, the C I had to take here was CR plus GR squared, 3/2, 1/4 pi squared, log of lambda squared divided by mu squared. And then, of course, I can replace the G by the GR. ER the parameter that I must take in my renormalized action in order to get finite renormalized 2- and 4-point functions. Is that clear? Because if I compute my correlation function in my theory using this renormalized action with those coefficients A, B, and C that are not 1, 0, G renormalized, but 1 plus, well, here is still 1. It's 0 minus some correction and G plus some correction. Then I get, and let me write them again. I need to have the mid. Now this is the front. Okay. Then again, the 4-point function. So let me write this. What's going on? Something is, it's not happy. Yes. So this is the front. So again, the 4-point function P1, P4, it can be rewritten as a renormalized 4-point function P1, P4 as a function of the renormalized coupling constant. And it is given by the formula above, and it is ultraviolet finite at order gr squared. And the 2-point function, let me call it the renormalized 2-point function, it is a function of P, well, it is a function of gr, but it's not very important. Here it's just P squared plus O of gr squared, so it is trivially ultraviolet finite. But the important, so those are the renormalized 2 and 4-point function, and they are finite. You see? So we succeeded in constructing a quantum field theory that at first order, so at one loop, is free of ultraviolet singularity, simply by taking an action is a functional integral that contains parameters that depends on the ultraviolet regulator and letting them behaving in a well-defined way when lambda goes to infinity. But that's all what we need. All what we need is renormalized 4-point function. Okay? Yes?
If we take the cutoff to infinity,
yes.
The answer is still divergent, right?
Who? Yes.
So we consider higher orders in fact.
Yes.
And another thing, what is the, how does this compare to the renormalization group scheme, for example, in statistical mechanics where you're eliminating modes?
I'm going to discuss that, tomorrow and on Thursday, because that's basically the same thing viewed from the other side. Okay. But one last remark. Well, I'm a bit late in my discussion, but first, you see that here I've discussed the 4-point function, and I defined the renormalized 4-point function. Here I've defined the 2-point function. And you can check that the n-point functions, gamma r, let's say at order n, that are given by, remember, loop diagrams, they are proportional to gr to the power, well, n divided by 2, because you have 2n legs for n. So if I am interested in the 2n point function with n larger than 2, so the 6-point function, the 8-point function, those diagrams are ultraviolet finite. So in fact, they don't require any renormalization, but since they start at order grn, up to leading order, they are ultraviolet finite. So all correlation functions are finite. Okay? And again, I discussed here only the irreducible four-point function because the diagrammatic is simpler. But the rules of, you know, going back to the connected correlation function and then to the Green's function of the theory via a Legendre transform and taking the exponential of the generic function, this works very well too. So basically, using this renormalized action with those coefficients here, A, B, and C, expressed as a function of the renormalized coupling and of the ultraviolet cutoff. By this formula, gives you ultraviolet finite correlation function, so vacuum expectation value of operator of the theory at first order in perturbation theory, so at one loop order. Okay? Good. So one last point that's very important and that I'm going to discuss tomorrow. We had to introduce this reference momentum point. So in fact, this depends, the four-point function depends both on the renormalized coupling and on the renormalization momentum scale. The two-point function depends also on it, but in a trivial way because the correction doesn't depend neither on GR or on mu. But the four-point function depends on this four-point function. So let me just So this is the front. I need to have the rear here. So you see, the renormalized four-point function, also the two that is written here, depends both on GR and on mu, the renormalization scale. So it seems that there is a new parameter introduced in the massless theory. The renormalized massless theory, remember, we have constructed a massless theory. We expect it depends only on a single parameter, the coupling constant, the coupling. It seems to depend in this formula from an additional parameter. What does it mean? Well, it means, in fact, that the renormalized coupling is defined from a theory with reference to a renormalization scale. So if you take a given physical theory with fixed, with a well-defined endpoint function. Okay, you are given the vacuum expectation value is in the vacuum of products of operator, and you are given all this for all your theory. So this defines all the physical quantity of your theory. Out of the correlation function, you can get back to the scattering amplitudes. You can get to a lot of things. You know your theory. Now, so in particular, you know what the four-point function here. So you know what the four-point function here. Now, if you consider a given mu, choose a renormalization scale mu. You get a renormalized coupling, the value for the renormalized coupling. Choose a different mu prime. You get a different renormalized coupling, G prime R. Simply because the renormalized coupling is defined as from extracted from the value of something you measure or you compute, here the four-point function, for a given choice of momenta here, or energies, at a given renormalization scale of energy or momenta. So it's not surprising that, in general, if you make a measurement at different energy, you can get different results. Therefore, you get different renormalized coupling. But in fact, these just, again, this is the same physical theory, of course. And you can check that. Okay, let me. Well, I will discuss that later. You can check that. You can compute what is the relation between GR and GR prime for different mu and mu prime. Okay? So, in some sense, I will just draw you a picture, one last picture, and then we'll discuss that tomorrow. The set of physical massless phi 4 theory, we expect that it depends on a single parameter, a single coupling. The theory may be a strong coupling, at weak coupling. Now, you can simply say that choosing a renormalization scale, so it's parameterized by just a single, it lives on a line. It depends on one parameter. Choosing a renormalization scales is like choosing a reference, a coordinate system. See, so I choose some coordinates system for coupling, for the coupling is for mu. You see, so. And if I have a given physical theory here, I found some given GR. You see. Now, I choose a different mu. It means that I'm choosing a different coordinate system. System associated to a mu prime different from mu. Then I get another value, you see. But this is the same physical theory, of course. It's a bit like measuring your just temperature. You can measure temperature in Celsius degrees, or in absolute temperature, or in Fahrenheit degrees. You get different results for the temperature, because you are measuring it with different objects, with different thermometers, graded at different, in different systems. So you get different numbers. But of course, the system is always at the same temperature. You see. So the fact that the renormalized coupling depends on the renormalization scale means simply that it depends on the measurement system you have chosen to measure the strength of the coupling of your physical theory, nothing else. So, in fact, there is only one parameter, not two. There is a one parameter space of masses theory, not a two parameter space. Okay. But tomorrow I'm going to discuss an important consequence of that fact, which is the fact that the coupling constant, the couplings depends on the energy. And this will lead to the context of renormalization group in perturbation theory. But that's a full subject. I've already been a bit too long. So let's discuss that quietly and in depth tomorrow. Okay? Yes? Yes. Yeah. Very good question. I was hoping nobody would ask. That's a very good question. Of course, in all those calculations we are doing in perturbation theory, we are doing perturbation in first order in the coupling constant and letting the cutoff go to infinity. And of course, we are unsure of what the limits are. So in fact, what we are doing is that we are taking the limit first, G goes to zero, then lambda goes to infinity. We are looking at order by order in the small coupling perturbative expansion. We are looking at how this terms behaves in lambda for finite lambda. And then we take the limit lambda goes to infinity. Of course, that's what we are doing here today. And in general, in perturbation theory, that's what we are doing. Of course, if we want to define in a non-perturbative way, a non-perturbative QFT, what we have to do is to construct a theory at finite lambda, find a way to take the limit lambda goes to infinity, and then take G to zero or some renormalized G to zero to construct perturbation theory. And it's not at all obvious that those two limits commute. In fact, in order to understand what's going on, whether we are allowed to do that, and in which case those limits commute, and in which case those limits do not commute, we need the formulation of renormalization group that you started to see in the statistical mechanical course. So in fact, I've been introducing you to the theory of renormalization in perturbation theory because that's very important both for calculation and for historical reason, because it's much more easier to do calculation in perturbation theory. But in fact, the correct framework to understand what's going on is the non-perturbative Wilsonian renormalization group formulation. But we are going to see that on the next 2 days, okay? So I think now you should have a break.